Hey guys, my name is Michael Hayes. Welcome to my YouTube channel. In this series of videos, we are helping you guys out there who are preparing to take the EC-6 subject core exam to become a TExES educator in elementary. So in this video, we're going to be looking at measurement. This is part two, and we're going to get started right after this. Okay, this is part two of our measurement series in science, and if you want to check out part one, you can click this card right here. If you're unable to see this card on your device, you can click in the description below, and I will have the previous video there as well. Also, if you want to get started in this series, we just started not too long ago, so you can actually check out the playlist here or in the description below, which will take you to the entire playlist of this video, previous videos, and ones to come. And so let's go ahead and get started. We're going to do 5-minute lessons, and I want to try to maintain that for each one of my videos. So we're going to get started right now, 5 minutes on the clock. So I want to start with accuracy and precision. Now, before I do that, I want to make sure you understand that we have to be in SI units. This is a rollover from the last video where we have to make sure our units of measurement match the same units of measurement all around the world. No matter what language you speak, in science we use the metric system. That is called the SI unit, or standard international unit. Very important that you know that coming up on the exam. So let's talk about accuracy and precision. You need to know the difference in those two words. So accuracy means how close to the real value is the instrument you are using to measure. Okay, so for example, you could have a triple beam balance that is manually operated, not a digital, and you can say, okay, we're gonna measure all these items on the desk, and you didn't calibrate that device, meaning you did not get it to exact zero when nothing was on it. And so that means everything you measure on that balance is going to give you the same off reading. So let's say that it's about 20 grams off and it's reading heavy. That means when it should have been on zero without anything on the actual plates, that you're actually reading at 20 grams. That means everything that you have, let's say you put a 5-gram object on there, it's going to read 25 grams. So everything that you're measuring is 20 grams off. So you have to calibrate your instrument before you start using it to make sure it is accurate. Okay, precision means how tight is that unit of measurement? So meaning how much guesswork are you having in the unit of measurement? So let's go back. I talked about SI units. Why do we not use the US unit? Well, nobody else uses it for one, but also it is not that precise. So let's take it an inch to look at from our ruler that has a foot length. So we break it down into inches. We can break that inch down into 16ths of an inch. Now, if you notice in between the 16ths, there is this gap where there are no marks, requiring you to guess, meaning less precision. I know that looks like very minor and small, but you know what? In science, very minor and small can make a big difference when it comes to people's healthcare and medicine and other things that we deal with in science. So let's compare that to the millimeter. When we look at the metric system, the meter is broken down into centimeters, which are then broken down into millimeters. And you notice there are a lot more millimeters in that same amount of inch space we had on the US system to give us a more precise measurement. Okay, that also comes into play when we talk about beakers and graduated cylinders. So even in the metric system, it depends on the instrument to see how accurate it is, or how precise it is. So let's take a look at a beaker right here. I'm going to put that one on the screen. If we look at the beaker, you notice that it has a lot of available space in between the measurement lines. That leads you to guess what it is. So if you have fluid in there, you're going to be guessing about exactly how much is in there based upon where that fluid level falls. If we look at a graduated cylinder, for example, you'll notice there are a lot more lines in between the main units of measure, like between the 10 milliliter and 20, or between the 1 and the 5, or the 10 and the 15. And so that allows our instrument to be more precise. Okay? So precise means we have more units of measurement that takes out the guesswork in what we are putting out there in our data, okay? So let's take a look at how we measure an unusually shaped object that we can't use the mathematical formula, say for a cylinder or a cone or a sphere, which gives us a very very good way to do that. But in science, we're dealing with natural world objects that don't have an exact shape. So for example, a student on the playground says, "Hey, I just found this little pebble on the playground and I want to check it out," and say, "Hey, okay, we could do that. We could check out what minerals are in it. We could check out the Mohs hardness of scale," which we're not going to talk about right now, but we're going to talk about how to measure the volume of that rock. So we can't just go to our mathematical formula and say, "Hey, this is a sphere," or "this is a conical shape," or whatever. We have to say, "This is an unusually shaped object. We know it takes up space, which is what volume is. So how do we measure that?" Well, we could take that graduated cylinder that is very accurate and very precise, and we could take a 100 milliliter graduated cylinder, and we could fill it up to the 50 milliliter mark, which means halfway up, with a clear liquid such as water, and we take that pebble now and we submerge it into the graduated cylinder. Well, what's going to happen to the water level? You guessed it, it's going to rise up just as though you were taking a bath and the water level rises. And so when that water level rises up after you put the pebble in it, you're going to subtract what the new volume is of the water in the graduated cylinder versus what it was prior to the pebble. So, for example, let's say that it was 50 when we started. Let's say for simple math that it rises up to 60 milliliters. The difference in those two is 10 milliliters. So our rock volume is 10 milliliters, okay? All right, let's take a look at our time. We have about 17 seconds. Let's talk about the meniscus. The meniscus is the curved line that you see on the graduated cylinder. We always measure from the bottom of the curved line because gravity is pushing inward on the volume of liquid that causes it to kind of sink in, and the water tension of the water itself is holding to the sides of the cylinder. Okay, we're going to stop right there as promised. There's one thing I didn't get to in this video that I meant to, and that's significant figures. So our next video that we're going to do coming up after this one is going to be on the scientific method. But I do want to talk about significant figures, so we'll start off the next video with significant figures, and then we're going to finish off with the scientific method. Now, the scientific method may take a couple videos to finish it up, but we will do what's necessary to make sure you get the information you need for the EC-6 Texas State Assessment. Thanks again for watching my video. I hope you will share, like, and subscribe. Please make sure that you tell your friends that these videos are out there and they're being produced currently, so we are trying to stay as close as what you need to be successful on the exam. Thanks for watching. We'll see you next time on Mr. Hayes' YouTube channel.